Let's get into this right now. Last week we talked about what Jesus said about his second coming, and we called the show I Trust What Jesus Said About His Coming. And tonight we're going to call this show I Trust What Jesus' Apostles Said About His Coming. And whether you realize it or not, all of the New Testament writers, apostles, fully expected, taught, and encouraged the believers who trusted in them in their day to believe Jesus was coming back to them then, on his way, that it was going to happen within 40 years, that it was going to happen sooner, that it was going to happen quickly. Now, we can't get around this fact. We will prove that tonight because we're going to begin to examine the apostles' words. And we have to ask ourselves, if Jesus' own apostles believed this, where did they get this information, this inspiration from? And the answer, they got it from Jesus himself. That's where they got it from. We might then ask, if the apostles were wrong and they misunderstood Jesus, then should we trust anything that they say? I mean, if the apostles couldn't get that right, when Jesus sat down with them and he told them what everything would look like when he's coming, if they couldn't get that right, how could we trust the rest of the New Testament and what they say there? I would go so far to say that if Jesus' apostles were wrong about when they said he would return, we can't trust a word of the Bible, not a word of it. But they were not wrong, not one of them. They were right, all of them, inspired by God, led as Christ's apostles. Jesus was not wrong. We're the ones who have been wrong. All these other people on earth have been wrong, but they were not. So tonight I'm going to start with the words of James. That's one of the apostles. He doesn't say too much about it. And we're going to then go to the writer of Hebrews. And then we're going to go to John. And then we're going to go to Peter. And then we're going to go to Paul. And not tonight. Just we're going to hit it quick and then let you go and we'll come back. There are five Jameses in the Bible, and this one who wrote this is believed to be the half-brother of Jesus Christ the Lord. He was martyred in 62 A.D., so his little epistle was written before 62 A.D. Remember, this was a letter written to believers at the time, Jews who had converted in all probability. Let me read this to you, emphasis mine. Chapter 5 of James, verses 7 through 9. Be patient, therefore, brethren. It's a letter written to them. Unto the coming of the Lord. Behold, the husbandman waiteth for the precious fruit of the earth, and has long patience for it, until he receives the early and latter rain. Be ye also patient. Establish your hearts. Ready? For the coming of the Lord draweth nigh. That's James, the brother of the Lord, saying it's drawing nigh. Grudge not one another, brethren, lest you be condemned. Behold, the judge stands at the door, meaning he's there getting ready to return with judgment and reward. That line, draweth nigh, that I just emphasized in the King James, is translated in the ESV and in the New King James as is at hand. Okay, so when something's at hand, if I am working on my car and I have a wrench and I have a need of a wrench and there's one not nearby as I'm working on the car, I say I need a wrench and someone says, "Do you have one at hand?" No, I can't reach it. It's not within my reach. So it's not at hand. If it's at hand, it's within our reach. That phrase there in the Greek means it's not far away at all. James could not have been talking about anything further away 50 years, 70 years. At hand does not mean anything, and that's really out there. 2,000 years later, it's no way James would have been wrong. So he was either leading those people in the truth, and they were trusting in his words as an apostle, or James was wrong. There's no ifs, ands, or buts. And that's why we've titled this show, the subtitle to it is, if you think you understand Christianity, you're probably wrong, because I'll bet most of you listening to this will realize you never knew this. Okay, let's go on. The writer of Hebrews, he says a little bit more. Forget about all the debate. We don't know who wrote Hebrews. We think it's Paul. There's evidence in there that it was Paul, but there's evidence in there that it wasn't Paul as well. But it was written to encourage Jewish converts. Hebrews, that's why it's called that, was written to the Jewish converts to hang on to their faith in Christ until he came, and to realize that in doing so, the promises that were made to them who believed were better than the promises of the old covenant. That's the basic nutshell of the book of Hebrews. So the writer's instructing them on what to do in the face of great persecution. Remember, if you were a Jew and you left Judaism, that was not really a smart thing to do if you wanted to have a peaceful, happy, successful monetary life. That would be one of the dumbest things you could do, because everything would dry up for you if you did. So this was an epistle written to the saying, listen, just this is what you need to do, hanging on into your faith. Let's read it. It says, Hebrews 10:22. Let us draw near with a true heart in full assurance of faith, having our hearts sprinkled from an evil conscience and our bodies washed with pure water. Let us hold fast to the profession of our faith without wavering, for he is faithful that promised. And let us consider one another, and provoke unto love and to good works, not forsaking the assembling of ourselves together, as some say, but exhorting one another, as so much the more as you see the day approaching. Okay? Now, this is the same day Jesus talked about when he says in Matthew 24 that day will be this. This is what it will look like. And the writer says, for if you sin willfully after you have received a knowledge of the truth, there remains no more sacrifice for sins, but a certain fearful looking of judgment and fiery indignation, which shall devour the adversaries. This is phraseology talking about the fiery judgment that was going to come upon Jerusalem. Understand that when he says that if you willfully sin after you have a knowledge of the truth, what that means is, how do you sin as a Christian? You deny the faith. You stop having faith. That's how you sin as a Christian. You stop having faith in Christ. So he says, if you willfully walk away from having faith in Christ, you're not going to escape the fiery indignation that's going to come upon the end of this age. Dropping down, he says, for we have need of patience, that after you have done the will of God, you might receive the promise. For yet a little while, and he that shall come will come and will not hesitate. Okay? Did you hear the promise by the writer of Hebrews to them? Reread it. And in a little while, do you know what the Greek term for little while is? It's micron. That means this. In a little micron of time. It cannot mean 100, 1,000, 2,000 years. The writer of Hebrews says, in a little while, he that shall come will come. If he's right, he's right. If he's wrong, then I don't trust anything the writer of Hebrews said. And then he says, now the just shall live by faith, but if any man draw back from faith, again, my soul shall have no pleasure in him, but we are not of them who draw back into perdition, but of them that believe unto the saving of the soul. It's not a great deal of information as we move through the different writers, but it's a good substantial chunk, okay? Now, let's go to the Apostle John. And we're not going to start with the Gospel, which he wrote. And we're not going to go to Revelation, which he wrote. We're going to start with the Gospel of John in his epistle, 1st, 2nd, 3rd John. And we're just going to cover, I think, 1st John, because I'm not sure there's much more about eschatology in 2nd. In 1st John 2, 17, 18, John the Beloved, who also, as I said, wrote Revelation and the Gospel, said, and the world passes away. That's how the King James puts it. The world passes away. He wrote that then. If you look at the translation of the Greek, it's the age passes away. This age of everything that is the Jewish temple and all the genealogy and the priests and all the old covenant, it's passing away. Paul said it's vanishing before our eyes. He says it's passing away, and the lust thereof. But he that doeth the will of God abides forever. And we know that the will of God is to believe on the Son. That's what John 6 says. Then John writes, little children, ready for this? This is John. It is the last time before the end of this age. Before the end of the world, as the King James puts it. It's not the whole world. It's the end of that age. It's the last time. All right? And then he says, and as you have heard that Antichrist shall come, remember those passages in Thessalonians that talk about an Antichrist coming? Even now, while he's writing, there are many Antichrists, whereby we know it is the last time. Was John right? I trust the Bible. I trust what John wrote. I think he was right. I don't think he was beguiled or wrong or saying something else, because the language won't allow him to be wrong. You can't say there's a micron of time left and mean many, 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 many thousands of years, or many thousands of years. And you can't say it's the last time when it's not. Okay? So completely fitting. And it's a fitting to the age of Nero and the beast and 666 and the Antichrist. We're going to talk about that in a few weeks if you tune back into the show. So John is saying, look around, present here. It's the last time the Antichrist, Nero was reigning then, is here. All right? And then in John 2:28, he says, and now, little children, abide in him, and when he shall appear, he's writing to them, we may have confidence and not be ashamed at his coming. We. He writes an epistle to them. They read it. We shall not be ashamed at his coming. Futurists today have read this 2,000 years. Oh, we can't be ashamed at his coming. Oh, we can't be ashamed at his coming. And they keep applying it to themselves. Listen, when you study Scripture, you got to look at the W's of Scripture. The who, what, where, why, and the H, how. And when is it taking place? Where is it taking place? Why is what they're saying being said? Who was saying it? What were they trying to impart? What was the purpose of it written? And when you do that, then you get a contextual understanding of the Scripture. If you ignore those W's in your study, you will then start doing one of the greatest mistakes people do with the Scripture. They read it and say, it's talking to me literally. It's materially speaking to me and my little egocentric day. The Bible was written and compiled and brought forth for me. It was, but spiritually, because it is the Word of God and it is living and true. But when you read it in a way where you think it was actually written and penned to you specifically, materially, to understand these signs, you really make a huge mistake. Okay, so obviously John was writing to encourage those to believe and abide. Finally, we have evidence of John instilling hope and expectation in the hearts of his readers and believers at that time. One last one. Consider 1 John 3:2, and we're going to wrap it up. He says, beloved, now are we the sons of God, but it does not yet appear what we shall be. But we know that when he shall appear, we will be like him, for we shall see him as he is. When he appears, this isn't talking about after death. John is telling them that we don't know what we're going to be like, but when we shall see him, when he comes, we know what we are going to be like. Was John blowing smoke? Was he correct in his encouragement? I would suggest totally correct. And if not, we can toss the Bible. Let's stop here. And next time, we're going to talk about what Peter and then Paul said about the coming of Jesus in that day.